I'm here with Martin Lundstedt, CEO of Volvo Group. Martin, it's so good to have you here.
No, thank you for having me.
And I have a few questions for you around sustainability, topics that are important for your company, and also supply chain topics. So let's get started.
Absolutely. Looking forward.
So you play a leading role in the transformation of internal combustion vehicles, now moving into electric car vehicles. And you actually had $6.6 million in sales, triple of what you had in 2019. It's truly remarkable. What are some of the unique supply chain challenges in this transition that you're facing?
First and foremost, I think that what we see now is that the technology in itself is viable. We have now also powertrains, as we say, for or propulsion system for heavy-duty applications and medium-duty applications. So that's number one. And number two, of course, is a big movement among our customers and their customers in driving the decarbonization. So they are willing to discuss how do we do this transition, both when it comes to the vehicle and the technology in itself, but also when it comes to charging infrastructure, the planning of the routings in order to have the right type of optimization of the ranges, etc. So the main driver, I think, is now technology is here, but it's also a strong willingness from our customers and their customers and society at large to reduce CO2 and to shape the world that we want to live in.
That's right. And what are your new priorities as you enter this space? And also, how do supply chains play a role into becoming more sustainable and reducing your greenhouse emissions?
First and foremost, if you look at the, if I just take a couple of sentences around the Volvo Group ambitions, we are adhering to the Paris Agreement most ambitious targets of 1.5 degrees maximum warming, meaning that by 2040, everything that we are shipping in terms of products and solutions must be completely fossil free across the globe, and we are in 190 countries. And the reason for that is that for 2050, everything must be fossil free, and our products are lasting at least 10 years amongst our customers, right? We have a very ambitious plan here, and that means also that regions like the Nordics here in Gothenburg, where we are now, or in Europe, North America, must be considerably quicker than that in order to cope with the global scale at 2040. So that is very important. But in order to make that happen, it is a play in the value chain, both upstream with our supply chain partners. How do we have the right type of material input, both for the batteries, that they are sustainable, socially, ethically, environmentally viable, but also that we have all other input materials like steel and aluminium and electronics and plastics that are fossil free, but also downstream, that we have this very strong partnership with our customers, their customers, in order to deploy this at scale. Both when it comes to the equipment, we had this fantastic deal with the performance team, Maersk company, as you are well aware of, in North America, in California, where this transaction is not a transaction that is transactional. It is a transaction that is partnership based, because we are building on a renewed fleet, including charging and infrastructure solutions, route planning, driver coaching, optimization in different shapes and forms, right? So this will create a whole different landscape, how we are interacting between each other, which I think is super exciting. And one of the reasons for that also, sorry for the long answer, but I'm very engaged in this, one of the key reasons that is happening in the key world that is important both to Maersk and to Volvo is that we are serving a lot of customers, corporate customers, right? And they, in turn, they have committed to science-based targets. What are those? Yeah, the science-based targets are based on that the company is going through the full CO2 consumption for that company, and they are looking where all the carbon dioxide consumed. Is it in old operation? Is it in bought energy? Or is it in the products in use that we are doing for our customers? And so suddenly everyone is connected. Because when I commit to something, I will ask Maersk to participate, and which you do today by decarbonizing, for example, your shipping. That will contribute to my decarbonization journey, since I'm a big customer with you. You follow? So this is really an interconnecting type of story. So partnership is the new leadership, because without the partners, you will never succeed.
Martin, that's really interesting. The performance team partnership, the trucks that we have now in California that are sustainable. Tell me about the evolution now from short haul into long haul when it comes to trucks and EV trucks in the future.
It's very exciting because, I mean, with the VNR electric that we are deploying together with performance team, that is the biggest actually electric order to date, not only for Maersk and Volvo, but in total, as I see it, for these type of applications, is still regional haul, but very important step. This year, we are actually introducing the next level for heavy-duty transportation on fully electric, so that will also go up to, you can say, 400 kilometers approximately. What is important to say here is obviously that what we will see to start with for the long haul is that it's also combined with the charging infrastructure, so you can plan this also with the routing together with the driver, resting times, etc. And thereby you can actually deploy it for at long haul applications as well. But in combination with battery electric, we also see that fuel cell or hydrogen electric vehicles will be very important for the long haul applications, where even more autonomy in terms of, you know, or independence are needed, because then you can actually charge more energy on board, right? So, but a very robust and strong roadmap. Now it is to continue, as we have done with the performance team, to share those roadmaps so we can plan on each side how do we actually continue to deploy this at scale.
That's very exciting. Now let's talk about technology and AI. You are truly a leader in automation and AI. If you've applied these technologies in your products. Tell me how important it is for Volvo collaborating with partners that have cutting edge technology.
First and foremost, as you say, I think what is very important is that this is, of course, a complete solution when we talk about autonomous driving, autonomous solutions. You know? And therefore, I mean, what we are doing is that we are providing a redundant sort of base vehicle that is prepared for really advanced automation. Then when it comes to the autonomous technology stack, we are partnering with a lot of different companies that have the cutting edge technology in order to have the best outcome. Like NVIDIA, for example, when it comes to processing capabilities, because it's a huge processing capabilities needed on board. We have a number of partnerships when it comes to the sensors that are required. We are continuous to work with a number of what we call virtual driver type of companies like Aurora in US, etc. But overall, it is the Volvo Group technology responsibility to get the act together. So thereby we're sitting on a lot of competence when it comes to, you know, the combination between hardware, software, but also, so to speak, the autonomous layer in the deployment stack, so to speak. So super excited. Confined areas are commercialized as we speak now. It will be like in quarries and mines and in ports and terminals, and then it will be step by step into semi-public areas, bigger logistic hubs, for example, and then in the next level also hub-to-hub transportation on public roads. So, but I think, you know, we have a strong technology background. Safety is deeply inherited in our DNA, so those must be absolute safe. They can actually enhance safety if rightly done in many cases. But also that we have already today 1.5 million connected vehicles around the globe, so we have gathered a lot of data about behavior, about thoughts that we are, to your point, also applying into, you know, machine learning to a lot of activities in order to make sure that our algorithms are safe and as a second step, then of course efficient and deployable.
Just a follow-up question to that. You know, truck driver shortage is a real issue, especially in North America. Do you see that truck drivers are starting to gravitate and accept this new technology as a way for improving safety, but also improving other areas of their support to our transportation industry?
No, but I think so, and I mean, what I think is important with automation always is to make sure that you have a human-centric deployment of all new technologies, right? And if you look at the industry in our plants and facilities, it is a long-lasting journey that we've had about automation. But we have also been able to show how good it has been for the interaction between man and machine in terms of, you know, improved safety, ergonomics, take out some of the really, repetitive and rather boring type of duties, etc. That is good. Here we need to interact together and not to make that as a hocus-pocus type of activity. Mm. If we do that, then I'm sure that it will be perceived as a very important thing. And the reality is that for certain applications, night driving, for example, on hub-to-hub applications between big logistics centers with long distances, like in North America or in Australia, whatever, it is a good way of actually deploying autonomous mode and utilizing the skill of the drivers for, you know, the handling, the heavy road conditions, or the optimizations in terms of, you know, coming in and out from a customer area. It's much better to utilize the capacity of our colleagues and their profession in the difficult stuff.
Yeah, Martin, is there anything else that you would like to add to this conversation?
First and foremost, I mean, just to have the opportunity to be together with all of you in Maersk has been a great opportunity. I think that we are showing together. We mentioned a number of examples here, both us as a customer to Maersk, but us as a solution provider to Maersk is showing that we are believing in the ecosystem, we are believing in partnerships, but also believing in action. Because what we are doing in these different type of examples is showing that we are not blaming the chicken and the egg situation, that we are waiting for someone else. We are coming together, we are doing things, and thereby we can be trusted partners to societies, to other customers, stakeholders, about driving the shift. And driving the shift into a sustainable society. I mean, I know that you're you're talking about leading with purpose as Maersk and as the leading logistic company in the world. We are talking about shaping the world that we want to live in. And let's do it together.
Let's do it together.
Thank you
so much, Martin.
Great to see
it's
you.
It's a pleasure meeting you.